Hey guys, Vikas over here and you are watching We Are Genius. Guys, before continuing, make sure you hit the subscribe button and hit the bell icon so that you will be notified each time I upload a new video. So guys, today I am with a new video around home automation. We will see how to get started with OpenHAB 2. In fact, this is going to be a series of videos around OpenHAB as I have completely shifted towards OpenHAB for my home automation system. Earlier actually I was using my own automation system built around PHP, Java and MongoDB. But day by day, it was becoming hard for me to manage that. So I thought of getting into already existing automation system, and with a bit of googling, I came across two major platforms which are OpenHAB and Home Assistant. Home Assistant is developed around Python and OpenHAB on the other hand is developed around Java. And as I am familiar with Java, I went with OpenHAB. One more aspect that I liked about OpenHAB is persistent, and that can be done by using different databases. So you can plot graphs and all, which is a little bit difficult in case of Home Assistant. And again, for that also we can use different databases like MySQL, Postgres, MongoDB and other, and that would actually help me as I am already using MongoDB and I don't want to change it. Again, you can choose from both of these, and if you want to go with OpenHAB, make sure to subscribe my channel and to check my other upcoming videos around it. So being said that, let's get started guys. So guys, to start with this, let's first download the OpenHAB runtime for system, and along with that we'll be downloading Eclipse Smart Home Designer. But again, you are not bound to download that. But if you are using Eclipse Smart Home Designer, that will make configuring OpenHAB much easier. Now, let's get into openhab.org. And before that, make sure you have Java installed on your system. So for me, actually, when I type in Java version on command prompt, it shows me that I have one active installation of Java onto my system. Now getting into the website, over here you can go through documentation, community, GitHub and other things, but I'll straight away get into downloads, and let's just download the runtime distribution of OpenHAB distribution 2.1. Over here again you'll find different things like add-ons and legacy add-ons. Legacy add-ons are those for the people who are actually using the older OpenHAB, that is version 1.x. And the add-ons, these actually contains different add-ons for OpenHAB, which you can install or add into your OpenHAB distribution. But we'll get into that later on other videos. Along with that, we get different mobile applications based on different OS, like iOS or Android or Windows. Then Eclipse Smart Home Designer, and this will actually help us to configure the OpenHAB 2 in a much easier fashion. Again, it is not compulsory that you will go with Eclipse Smart Home Designer, but again, it will just make things simple. You have various distributions of it, like for Windows, Mac OS X and Linux. So I'll go with the Windows 32-bit one as I'm running Windows 7 32-bit. And below that, you'll get the OpenHAB 1.x distribution. Again, we are not getting into those things. Now just wait for some time till the download get completed. Now, after the download completes, just unzip the two downloaded files, that OpenHAB and the Eclipse Smart Home Designer. So wait for some time till the extraction finishes. So now, after the extraction completes, get into the OpenHAB 2.1 folder that is currently, and over here you will get different folder and files, out of which start.sh, if you are using it with a Linux system, you definitely should run this script. Otherwise, if you are using Windows, like over here, we should run it, and we should run it as administrator. Click on yes. And so as it will be doing some initial configuration, it might take some time. So just wait for that. Again, if you want to enable the debugging, you should start the startdebug.bat or batch file. And it is asking for this network access. Click on yes. Now head on to your browser and type in localhost and the port that is being used by OpenHive by default is 8080, and you'll see the web interface of OpenHive 2 should come up, and over here you will get different packages like simple, standard, export and demo UI. So I'll go with the standard one, and again you can select anything that you are interested in, but for beginners this is recommended. So this is again configuring, so it might take some time, so just wait for it. Now while this gets initialized and all, let's get into the OpenHive folder that we have extracted, and over here you'll find different folders like add-ons, conf, runtime and user data, out of which add-ons are used if you are going to download these like add-ons bundle over here, OpenHive website, or if you are going to use any third-party add-on, you should place those inside this folder. And the conf folder contains all those configuration which again we'll be accessing using the Eclipse Smart Home Designer later on in this video. So this contains all those sitemaps, persistence rules, the things that we'll be creating with the OpenHive. The runtime contains all those runtime like data and all. The user data contains the JSONDB, that is the by default persistent that comes with the OpenHive. Again, we'll get into that later on in other videos. And there are other like folders also, but our point of interest is the add-ons and the conf folder. So let's parallelly install or use the Eclipse Smart Home Designer that we have downloaded and extracted earlier. So I'll just open it up, and again over here I have installed OpenHive and this Eclipse Smart Home Designer onto same machine, but again if you are using OpenHive on a different machine, you should enable the drive sharing feature, or the you should share the drive of the server where you have installed the OpenHive, then only you can use the Smart Home Designer. Otherwise you will not be able to access the configurations and all, because that requires file sharing. Let's see if it is done. Yeah, so after the initial configuration is done, you'll get three UIs for yourself, like the basic UI, the app panel and the paper UI. So to use app panel, you need to configure sitemaps and all, which again we'll check on later. Then you have two options like basic UI and the paper UI. So if you are getting into configurations, like if you want to add devices or you want to write some rules and all, you should get into paper UI. But if you want to just monitor the things that you have already used or installed with the OpenHive, you should go with this basic UI or app panel. Again, basic UI also requires sitemaps to be declared to use this. So let's get into paper UI, which actually lets you configure your OpenHive in a way that means you can add things and all. It makes you it lets you discover different like smart appliances and all. So you have different options over here, like you can control already added things or devices. You have inbox where all the discovered like devices or things appears. Then you have configuration, that is you can configure system bindings, different services, things and different items. On add-ons, you can browse through different add-ons, those are available for OpenHive 2, and if you are interested in anything, let's say you are using MQTT or something, you should install the required add-ons for that. And for that you can simply search for that, like if you are, let's say, getting into persistence and you want to use like SQLite or something, you should install the respective add-on. Again, you have transformation, that is for different transformation. Again, you will get into that in other videos. You have different options for user interfaces. So along with those three interfaces I showed you earlier, you can have different other interfaces too. So get into bindings, and over here I'll just use one simple binding. There are actually various add-ons like air quality, alarm, Play, Amazon Dash button also that is available. Then Chromecast binding is also available. Then Kodi binding is available. Along with that, if you are using Raspberry Pi for your OpenHAV, you can also use GPIO binding. For HTTP calls, you can use HTTP binding. For Philips Hue, you can use Philips Hue binding. And all the things are here. I'll install the MQTT binding, but because in future I'm going to use some like MQTT based protocols to communicate with some of the applications that I am having in my mobile and all. I'll also use this OwnTrax. Again, that depends upon you, whatever add-ons that you want to install. So after installing the add-ons, you can do some simple configurations if you want to change anything. Like if you want to go with different persistent service. So in my case, I'll go with MongoDB, but I'll make a separate video for that, which actually you need some configuration for that. But if you are running any other like database services, you can go with that. And that's all about it over here. We'll get into different things later on. I'll get items, things. Then over here we have our one service, that is the OpenHAV Cloud Connector we installed recently. So that's about it. So let's see the last thing, that is the Eclipse Smart Home Designer, how to get started with this. Now get into run. Sorry, not this thing, on this, get into this folder over here, configuration, and select your conf folder location. Again, if you are running your OpenHAV instance on your network, like on your other system, on your network, you can do such by getting to network. And the PC that you are running your OpenHAV on, so for me this OpenHAV. And select the conf folder. Again, this is, I've just selected another instance of my OpenHAV. This is not the fresh one. And this will show you different configurations and the different items which you can select and configure. Let's say for me, I want to access the persistence. I can simply get into the MongoDB persist file. Actually, as I'm using MongoDB with my OpenHAV installation, and you can simply configure your settings on this. So again, we'll check like how to use MongoDB later on some other video. And again, if you are not interested in using Eclipse Smart Home Designer, you can also configure by getting into the conf folder. Let's say this is, I was showing the log. Get into the conf folder, config, this is the conf folder, and getting into, let's service, I'll just, let's say I want to change the MQTT config file, as I have installed the MQTT binding. Get into this, and you can pretty much use any text editor or notepad to change the configurations. Yep, over here we'll, you can change the configuration pretty much same way as you can do with the Eclipse Smart Home Designer. But the Eclipse Smart Home Designer also features syntax highlighting that may make your life easier while configuring the OpenHAV. So that's all with this, guys. We saw how to install OpenHAV on Windows and how to configure it to get started. And I hope you have enjoyed it. And actually, I'll be coming with more videos around OpenHAV, like using MongoDB with OpenHAV and using ChartJS, using OwnTrax, all those things on later videos. Even if I'll go with like hardwares with OpenHAV, like using ESP266, Raspberry Pi and all things with OpenHAV to make a complete home automation system around it. So if you have enjoyed this video, make sure to hit the like button. And if you have not subscribed yet, you can definitely subscribe to it for videos like this on home automation and different IoT and embedded system aspects. So see you next time with my next video. Till then, goodbye.